William Morrow and Harper Audio present Woke Up This Morning, The Definitive Oral History of the Sopranos by Michael Imperioli and Steve Schirripa. Read by Aspen Vincent, Chris Shula, Christina Delane, Dan Bittner, Eliza Foss, Eva Kaminsky, Fred Berman, Jeffrey Cantor, James Lurie, Jason Culp, Kathleen McInerney, Lisa Flanagan, Michael Imperioli, Nancy Peterson, Oliver Wyman, Richard Ferrone, and Steve Schirripa.
For Jim.
To Victoria, Isabella, Vadim, and David. Love forever. Michael.
To the loves of my life, Laura, Bria, and Sierra. Steve.
Introduction. This almost never happened.
This audiobook grew out of our podcast, Talking Sopranos, which started airing in April of 2020 and quickly found a great following of wonderful, dedicated fans. They've been enormously supportive of us from day one. Actually, from before day one.
Because if it weren't for them, we wouldn't be here now.
See, the Sopranos had been off the air for nearly 15 years now, but the fascination with the show has never ebbed. In fact, there seem to be more people watching it now than when it originally aired. The support of the fans, both those who are watching it again and those who are discovering it for the first time, has been fantastic.
We started noticing it around the time we were celebrating the 20th anniversary of the show's premiere, early in 2019. I was working on a pilot in New York that March and shooting a scene in Central Park when a young man, maybe all of 20 years old, walking through the park with his father, politely approached me. He said they were from Scotland, visiting the city for the first time, and were so excited to see a cast member from their favorite show. Suddenly, the young man rolled up his pant leg and revealed a tattoo of my face on his calf. He explained that he had discovered the show in the past year, and it had quickly become a huge part of his life, to the point where he felt the need to have one of the show's main characters permanently etched into his flesh. It gave us both pause. What the heck was going on out there?
It was about that time we both entered the wild, wild wilderness of social media via Instagram and Facebook. Before long, it became evident to us that the Sopranos had found an entire new flock of passionate followers. We found tons of fan pages, meme pages, Soprano fashion pages, Soprano food pages, Sopranos music pages, you name it. I mean, it was obvious that social media was the domain of the young, and these teens, 20-somethings and 30-somethings, were now streaming the Sopranos on their iPhones and Androids.
We'd known for a long time that we had legions of loyal fans, most of them close to our own age, give or take a decade or two. But the fact that we were being taken up by a whole new demographic gave us an idea. Not many shows have the ability to be passed down to a younger generation that embraces it as wholeheartedly as their parents did. And so we wondered, what if we tried to meet these newfound devotees on their own turf? The podcast.
The two of us had worked together on a ton of projects, both Sopranos related and otherwise. I mean, we did a movie called Nikki Deuce, based on a book by me. The movie The Hungry Ghost, written and directed by Michael, which I starred in, and a number of other films.
We also did a stage show along with Vinny Pastore, you know him as Big Pussy, called Conversations with the Sopranos, which we toured around the country and as far away as Australia. And we're very close friends in real life. When one of us gets to go on vacation, the other's the first one to get a call to come along and bring the family.
So when the idea came up to do a podcast in which two buddies would sit down and chat, rewatch all 86 episodes of The Sopranos, and bring on all the other cast members, directors, producers, writers, everybody, from the sound guy to series creator David Chase, it seemed like a natural. It was announced. We did a whirlwind press tour, and we're ready to go into the studio to record together starting March 25th.
And then COVID hit.
On March 13th, the day a national emergency was declared, the day the world stopped turning for all of us, Michael was stuck in California, sick as a dog. Later, we realized he and his wife probably had come down with COVID. I was holed up with my family in my apartment in New York, depressed as hell. The thought of doing the podcast remotely never occurred to us. I mean, we didn't even know it was possible. None of us had even heard of Zoom yet.
And besides, to be perfectly honest, we didn't think we should do it anymore either. We thought doing a podcast in the midst of all this tragedy was totally tone deaf. After all, who could possibly want to hear us talk about a TV show with all the suffering that was going on in the world?
But then we started hearing from fans, both the older generation who watched the show back in the day and the legion of new young followers. We're stuck at home, they told us. We're sheltering in place like we're supposed to. We're binge-watching The Sopranos. We're waiting for the podcast. We want you to watch it with us.
Where the hell are you?
And so, reluctantly, we started talking to our producers about trying to do the podcast from our homes. We had a crash course in virtual programming, in creating home studios, in setting up our lights and mics and backgrounds. I mean, we didn't even have time to talk about what the hell we were going to do once the tape started rolling. On March 30th, we just jumped into the deep end and recorded our first show.
We were both depressed and worried as hell. We had a mutual friend who passed away just before we went to air. But here's what Steve said on that first podcast.
If we could give you a moment of joy, I guess that's what we're doing. I'm in the house 23 hours a day. I know people have it a lot worse than I do. Listen, we'll do it for the fans. We'll do it for ourselves. We'll see what happens.
And here's what happened. As soon as that first episode aired, we heard from a ton of people saying they wanted more. They told us that listening to the podcast buoyed their spirits and hearing their kind words buoyed ours. More than they'll ever know.
Our depression started to lift. We did another episode, and another. And soon all the old gang started showing up. Lorraine Bracco, Edie Falco, Vinnie Pastore, John Ventimiglia, everybody. It was like homecoming week every week. Pretty soon, we got to the point where we couldn't wait to do the next episode. Being with the Sopranos gang always had a kind of Rat Pack feel to it. Whenever we got into the studio or met on location, it was always just like hanging out with your old friends on the corner. And this podcast brought that all back to us. It was like no time had passed at all. Only this time, we got to bring all our fans along for the ride.
So once a week, we all got to forget about our troubles for an hour or two. In the time of COVID, that meant everything to us.
In the process, we got to revisit the greatest TV show ever, and in doing so, realize what made it so great. In rewatching the series all these years later, we came to an appreciation and understanding of how unique a moment in time this series represented. What an unparalleled gathering of talent, and how it changed the world of television forever. There isn't a dramatic series anywhere, on network or cable, that doesn't owe something to The Sopranos.
And so what you're about to listen to sprang from that podcast and more directly from the renewed passion for the series that we first encountered when that young man rolled his pants leg up in Central Park and showed me a tattoo of my own face. Some of this is drawn from conversations we had on the podcast. A lot of it stems from conversations we had once the cameras and microphones were turned off. On the podcast, we went episode by episode. We won't do that here, but we will delve deep into the key moments, the best scenes, the astounding acting, and the brave, eyes-wide-open look at the moral choices we all have to make, as embodied by Tony and Carmela and Christopher and Adriana and good old Bobby Bacala. We'll rediscover the incredible writing, the unparalleled direction, the stunning cinematography, the side-splitting humor, the brilliant use of music, all the things that went into the making of The Sopranos. These are the inside stories, the behind-the-scenes tales, the how-they-do-that insider info that only the folks who created it and lived it can tell.
And we decided not to hold anything back because, after more than 20 years, we figured, what the fuck? Let's just let it all out.
And so we did.
In one sense, we did this for selfish reasons. It has been a wonderful gift to be given the chance to go back and visit with all our old friends. And we had a ball watching the shows. They not only stand the test of time, they've somehow grown better with age.
But mostly, we did it because you asked us to.
Happy to oblige.
Michael Imperioli.
Steve Schirripa.
1. Getting the band together. By the time it was over, The Sopranos had garnered 112 Emmy nominations and 21 wins. It was nominated for Outstanding Drama Series over and over and finally won in 2004, a first for cable television. But let's begin at the beginning, or more precisely, a year before the beginning. When Steve and I sat down to do Talking Sopranos, the first thing I realized was that I'd never really heard the full story of how Steve wound up on the show. Turns out, Steve wanted to know the same about me. It led to a discussion that we had with all of the old gang, and everybody's story was different. It's hard to believe after all these years how many twists and turns and odd coincidences went into creating the strange alchemy that was The Sopranos. What follows is a synthesis of those conversations, melded with the story behind the story as told by the only two people who are always in the rooms where it happened, the casting directors, Georgianne Walken and Sheila Jaffe.
What the hell is strange alchemy? I mean, how do you meld the synthesis? Who says that? Forget that crap. Let's just tell the stories. Take me back. It's 1997. You're an actor in New York. You're what, 31 years old? You get the call from your agent.
I really have to give credit to the casting directors, Sheila Jaffe and Georgianne Walken. They were champions and advocates for me for a lot of projects, and they always had me in mind. We became friends, and so anything I'd be remotely right for, they'd bring me in. And they said, there's this series casting for HBO. Come meet the director and the writer. There were no real series on HBO at the time. It was a very new thing. So I read the script, and I'm going to be honest. I can't say I was blown away or it knocked my socks off. Partly because from the pilot script, it's not easy to get the tone completely. For one thing, it was very funny. I wasn't sure if it was a spoof. There was a movie on Showtime called The Don's Analyst with Robert Loggia, which was terrible. It was a bad spoof. And another script was floating around for a movie that was in the works, Analyze This. They were all being made around the same time. So when I first read the pilot of The Sopranos, I wasn't sure if it was another spoof.
Where were you in your career?
I had done a lot of movies, mostly independent movies, and theater. So I'm paying the rent. I had just done a big Hollywood movie the year before called Last Man Standing, and I had done a couple of leads in two independent movies. But, you know, the idea of a series, you read one script and you sign on for maybe 100 scripts. I had never done that. So when I read the script, I was kind of, do I want to do it? Do I not?
Did you know David Chase or any of the other actors?
I didn't know David Chase, the creator and writer, but I did know some of the actors they were talking about, like Edie Falco, Tony Sirico, Vinnie Pastore, and Lorraine Bracco, who I knew a bit from Goodfellas. Lorraine was the only star at this point. She was nominated for Goodfellas. Jim Gandolfini, I didn't know, but he had a good reputation. So I went and auditioned for David. My character, Christopher Moltisanti, his name in the original pilot script was Dean Moltisanti, which never would have worked as well. Nothing would have worked except for what worked. You know what I mean? Nobody else would have worked. What it is what it should have been.
How long is this after you did Goodfellas?
That was maybe 8 years before.
You were Spider in that movie. Not a huge role, but a very memorable role. Everybody remembers Spider.
In the business, everybody knew who I was. People on the street would recognize me.
I mean, what were they saying? Hey, Spider, get me a drink? Is that what they were doing?
Ha, no, thank God. That would have been horrible. I would have been miserable.
I mean, before we move on, didn't something really strange happen after your big scene in Goodfellas?
So when I did the second scene in Goodfellas, when I get shot in the chest, I decided to do the stunt myself. They attached all these squibs to me for where I got shot.
Explain squibs, I mean, for people who don't know.
They're little explosive devices, almost like a little weak firecracker. They're attached to you and they puncture the clothes to make the bullet holes. They're remotely controlled, so the special effects guy can set them off as you're getting shot. And usually they have blood packs underneath that get exploded and you react to them. The shot required me to go flying back, hit the bar, hit the ground. They padded me up and we rehearsed it a little bit. I had a glass in my hand that I was bringing to the table and it was not a breakaway glass. When I hit the ground, the glass cut my fingers open pretty badly. Marty Scorsese yelled, "Cut! Don't move! Nobody move!" I'm on the ground and there was blood everywhere and I knew I fucked my fingers up. I looked up and De Niro was looking down at me like, oh shit. They rushed me to the hospital because...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.